My name is Alvin Yakuri. I am a research fellow at the African Center of Technology Studies, ACTS. ACTS is an intergovernmental organization that works on policy research in three programmatic areas: agriculture and food security, two, energy and water security, and three, environmental governance. We are based in Nairobi, Kenya.
Alvin, I understand you've been presenting here in Cancun on the subject of strengthening community-based adaptation through local institutions. Could you just explain what community-based adaptation is and what it refers to?
Community-based adaptation is, we are looking at how people at the grassroots level are adapting to climate change. And what it is that we did for community-based adaptation for sure is looking at identifying their vulnerabilities with them. So it is about working with communities identifying their vulnerabilities and at the same time working through the adaptive strategies by themselves with the help of the researchers.
I understand that your recent research has been involving 8 countries in East and Southern Africa. Could you tell me about what were some of the big conclusions coming from the study?
We did a study in 8 countries, and our approach was to look at how local institutions, for sure, are strengthening the adaptive capacities of these communities. At the same time, looking at how these particular stakeholders that are working in this particular project are also going to be capacitative, for example, in terms of community-based adaptation. So one of the key highlights for sure that we identified was that institutions, people in various institutions, both at the local level, national level, were capacitated in terms of climate change. At the same time, we identified adaptive strategies at the village level with communities, and those communities that we did not work with are actually learning more about from the other communities and what we've done, and they're interested, so they are calling out for more. They want they themselves also to learn more on community based adaptation and implement some of these projects. And thirdly, we've had academicians coming to us and wanting to have these case studies to be used for PhD level for analysis, and at the same time at the master's level for analysis. And so there was a lot of action learning between the researcher and the community at the same time, you know, learning by doing. So in both ways, the researcher and the community benefited from the project.
Did you see this as one-way learning mainly, or was it two-way learning?
This is a two-way learning because the researchers, one, did not know how, for example, how the communities work, for example. So it's a way the researcher learned from the community how they do their things, how they identify their vulnerabilities, for example. For example, we could go to a community and in our perspective, from our perspective as a researcher, that this is could be the issue that these communities are looking out for. But our surprises were that it was the other way around. So it's about learning, a two-way learning, the researcher as well as the community. So it's sort of like capacity building on both sides. And we did a lot of work on participatory process. And that meant that the two people that were working together had to learn a lot from each other. And this has been appreciated very much.
This challenge of bringing together local knowledge and expert knowledge is an issue across a wide area in this climate change arena. You must have found that at the beginning you were talking a different language. Does that change over a period by working together?
Well, I believe it does change over a period because the researcher will then sort of internalize some of these processes, and at the same time the farmer will then learn from the researcher on some of these informal, for example, processes. And that, well, I really can't say it can, if a mind is set for the farmer not to change, then, and the researcher is willing to change, it can be 50-50, but it's something that we have to work on for a long time, so that, because it's not easy to change the farmer's perspective, for example. I'll give you an example. When we were at the community level and we talking through with the communities about crop diversification, for example, as an option. And one of the crops was maize. And one of the farmers told me, I will never leave, I'll never stop growing maize. That's a crop that I've always done and I'll never stop. So we as researchers realize that that will take some time, but we have to continuously talk through together and, you know, inform each other on some of the gains of crop diversification, for example. But one thing I realized was that those farmers that took up, that had an open mind, for example, they benefited from some of the work we were doing together. And the other communities, farmers that saw the best practice, for example, what the other farmers got, like got better yields by planting, for example, other crops or planting at a required time, they came back to us and say, you're actually right, we will do the way you say. And I mean, that's a mindset change, which it can happen simultaneously, but sometimes some of the farmers can take some time, communities.
How much did you find that farmers were already alert to the climate changing? Was this something which is actually a common knowledge for them?
Well, interesting enough is that some of the projects, for example, in the case of Kenya, we did a project in a flood-prone area, and this area has been flooding over the years, as long as the communities have lived there. So at our entry point, when we started speaking about climate change to them, that it's happening, of course they say, that's not new to us. We've been having floods all through, but we want something, you tell us something new. So what we did was to start from how we've been coping with this particular phenomenon of climate change and floods, for example. So by us learning how they've been coping with it, it's when we brought in the whole idea of now not coping anymore, but now adapting to the very, because adapting takes a long time. Coping is a very short, takes a short time. So that is where we reached at, and it was very useful for us to learn how they've been doing things in the past, and that was coping, but now we're introducing another phenomenon for them to adapt, which is a very longer, takes a longer time frame.
I'd be interested to know, Elvin, what's happening next with your research? Where are you going to go next with this?
It's interesting, actually, on the way forward for our project, for our research, for example. Like I said earlier, we had it in 8 countries, and all these 8 countries have identified, together with the communities, the adaptive options that they want to move on. The fact that our research was more on capacity building, now that we've done the capacity building of the communities, they have an idea, they have knowledge on what climate change is and how to adapt. We are trying to move forward by implementing the options and adaptive strategies that their communities themselves, together with the researchers, identified. So it's sort of implementation at the moment.
And who's going to be responsible for driving that implementation phase? Is that coming from you or is that coming from the communities?
I must say it is a collaborative effort. In some of the countries that we did, we have already the government coming in, different sectors of government. For example, in Kenya, we have the Kenya Agricultural Research Institute coming in to take up some of the activities together with the communities, but be reminded that the communities identified these strategies, and then now the government, it's coming in to help them implement some of these adaptive strategies, which is a very good thing because they own the process, so we believe that the uptake will be much faster than if we went in with our own ideas. This is their own ideas, and then they're getting support from the arm of government that is required to do that.
So do you think this is an approach which could be used in other areas as well and scaled up?
Yes, that's a very, very good approach that should be used, because one, you think you're talking in terms of ownership of these communities, owning the whole process. In the past, we've always had to get to the community, tell them what to implement, then we move out. But at the moment, the communities have owned the process. So as the researcher moves out of the community, they are more of like the steers of the whole project. So which we believe is much more sustainable than if it were top down. So this kind of collaboration, I think it's a much better way of doing things.
And how are you finding the higher level administrators and policymakers responding to this approach of of being receptive, being more receptive to the local ideas?
I must say, for particular cases, it was very impressive that the government, for example, had to come in and help the communities implement. What, for example, in Kenya, what I must say is that it was unique for this Kenya Agriculture Research Institute to come in quickly and say, oh, you've identified this. It was actually part of our strategy, but we hadn't gotten there. But since we're already here, let's move on from what you have chosen to do, which was a good thing. We appreciate that the bureaucracies at the government level can take time, and the communities can actually take forever to, you know, some of the activities to be implemented. But I think I must say that it is an impressive effort from the government to try and actually come in and work with the communities as much as possible on what they've decided to do.